And welcome back. So we're just about to head into Renengild's house. Last couple episodes we met Zawa, I believe if I'm saying it right, the monk. We are going to have him join the party at some point, not just yet though. We met Teodor here, who wants us to find a thermal pearl in Longwatch Falls. He told us about two dangerous groups, the Sister of the Slake Skull and the Gleaming Society. Also, Isto wants us to test her metal detector type thing on the mountains of Jurgen's Battery. Okrin wants us to get his medallion back from Lafta. And, yeah. Other than that, a few other people want us to find stuff. He nods. Been keeping an eye on town here. You, found anything out near Longwatch for me? Coughs into his hand. Haven't left yet. He's got villagers. Here's this Rayfall guy that I mentioned. You're a nice change from the usual madcaps and mercenaries. Renengild does her best, but there's not much work outside the fishery. What's this place here? Oh, that's the Grave's Rest, I believe you say it. This guy is like freezing. Let the guy inside. Okay, we're gonna talk with Renengild.
They've destroyed the stockade, Mother! It's...
So this is Uldric talking.
Enough. They're gone.
Oh, Renengild is female. For some reason I thought Renengild like an old dude. Huh. Older woman. She holds up a hand, which is missing the final joint of the ring finger, but it's her voice, sharp and steely, that silences the young man. As he glowers at his toes, she turns to you with dark circles under her eyes and a smile pulled taut across her thin lips.
The deliverer of Cadnua. Thank you for making the journey. Abidun knows it's a long one.
Yeah, I know too.
Well, I'm sure you wagered on a more civilized welcome. Still, we're much obliged for your capable intervention.
She shoots the young man a brief but stern glare. He pulls a knife from his belt and an apple from his pocket and sets to work. Okay, you eating apples? It's an honor to be called here.
That's fine of you to say so, though I'm hoping your strengths lie more with arms than words.
She folds the map in her hand with a quick and merciless pinch.
Stalwart isn't much more than a grease stain on a map. What roads we've got in the White March are basically tracks in the snow. And for every traitor or adventurer that comes through, three of our own leave for good.
I'll mention that I did lower the voices and the music just a bit. Since, seemed kind of loud compared to my voice, anyway.
But it weren't always so. There was a time when kings and queens sent their firstborn to these mountains, when the White March was the envy of empires.
Her eyes shine, and for an instant, she looks like a much younger woman. Much younger woman. Alas says, how the mighty have fallen. What an era that must have been for the White March. It'll show interest.
The Pargrin dwarves transformed the White March once. We could bring some of that greatness back to Stalwart. But we need the White Forge.
She raises the map and taps a spot in the middle of a white and gray expanse. So try to impress her with our lore and just say I know of it.
Then you'll know that no one's felt as much as a summery breeze from the White Forge for over 200 years.
She smooths the creased map.
I'm hoping you can do something about that.
She ignores the young man, who shakes his head at the crackling logs. How so?
We've been trying to breach Durgan's battery for over a year now. Problem is, the other expeditions can't so much as dent the front door.
She rubs at her fatigue-shadowed eyes. Tell me about these other expeditions.
A dozen different groups have come through at our request, and several more besides. Been hoping that one of them could clear the way through Durgan's battery. But young or old, green or seasoned, it don't seem to matter. They cast their spells, chisel at the door, and search the grounds until they've worn new treads into the old stone. The lucky ones eventually go home. Plenty more find themselves on the wrong side of a blizzard, or an ogre raiding party.
Why the sudden interest in the White Forge?
We're an old mining town. Or we were until the Adirans pulled out and left us with a half-dug mineshaft and something resembling an inn.
She thumps the sturdy wooden wall with her fist.
Since then, it's been a steady decline. You've seen the roads. Isn't much we can produce that the Valians can't ship cheaper.
Palagina says, it is what we do.
But the White Forge. Well, if we could fire it up again and start producing Durgan steel, or something close to it, wouldn't matter if we're in the White March or the Living Lands. Business would come.
She folds her arms and gives you a stiff nod. The young man says nothing, but he tosses a sliver of the apple peel into the fireplace. And that's why you need my help.
That's the long and short of it. We're laborers and fisherfolk, not adventurers. But Durgan steel could put Stalwart on the map again. Open up the mines, bring in new business. We just need the White Forge.
She thumps the desk with her fist. Many questions. I don't see why you need the White Forge to make good steel.
Finally, someone talking sense.
He raises his knife and half-peeled apple to the fire in a dramatic gesture of exasperation.
Durgan steel wasn't just good. It was some of the best. We need the best if we're going to keep Stalwart alive.
She glares at Uldric even while she speaks to you.
No one alive today has seen the White Forge, but the old stories tell that it was powerful, glowed white-hot, and gave off a steady, even heat, unlike any other furnace. Let better-schooled folk puzzle over how the thing was built. I just want to see it put to use.
Stupid. I want to ask all the questions. She just explained to us why Durgan steel is so special.
Because you can shave stone with it, cleave cast iron in two, and the stuff's as rare as it is remarkable.
In her enthusiasm, Renengild shifts on the balls of her feet. She props one bent arm on the other, pointing distractedly toward the eaves of the house. Palagina says, steel is steel. It may be light, and it may take an edge well, but per complanca, complanca, the legends grow with each passing year. I do not know that word.
If we could make something even half as good, we'd have a market at our doorstep and work enough for all of Stalwart.
For a split second, her gaze flickers to Uldric. So, what happened to Durgan's battery?
It don't bear dwelling on. There's too many superstitions about that place as it is.
She waves her mangled hand in a broad crescent, averting her gaze.
Killed each other off, or so the old books say.
He glares at Renengild through hooded eyes.
Plenty of tales to go around, but none of them open the battery. And the last thing people need is another reason to fear the place.
She scowls at him. Canna says, Kith do enjoy their ghost stories, though the Glanfathans take theirs very seriously.
Whatever it was, the other Pargrin dwarven settlements in the White March, Bone Picker, the Hawk, and the rest, emptied out not long after, moved to gentler, greener lands.
Had the right idea, if you ask me.
How is it no one's gotten into Durgan's battery yet?
Where should I start? Ogres, blizzards, or sheer damned inaccessibility?
She ticks the items off on her fingers.
It ain't for lack of trying, I'll tell you that much. Got untold riches in Durgan steel lying just inside, and never mind the White Forge itself. The Adirans who first settled Stalwart tried to crack it. So did the Valians, and every other cocky adventurer with more metal than sense.
She folds her arms, shaking her head at a pitted floorboard.
But the place has a funny way of sealing itself up. Front door stays shut, the tower entrances are clogged with rubble, and it's been impossible to blast a way in.
Renengild trails off, and for a moment the room is silent but for the popping and crackling of the fire. Tell me about the Pargrin dwarves.
Pargrin's a word in their language. Means traveler. They've been wanderers for generations, but I couldn't tell you much more.
All right. Any idea of where I should begin?
The battery's up the mountain to the north. A good hike away.
She jerks her head in the direction of the slope behind the house.
Near Galvino's place, huh?
Uldric says it in a breezy tone, but Renengild falls suddenly silent, consternation hardening the lines of her face. He smiles and draws his knife across the apple again.
So it is, though I was going to suggest dealing with that ogre camp before anything.
She compresses her thin lips into a frown. Who's Galvino?
Mestre Galvino, as the old crosspatch prefers it, lives by himself and keeps the wilder and beasts at bay through sheer foulness of his temper.
She rolls her eyes.
She means to say he's a skilled smith and animancer, who's lived in the shadow of Durgan's battery for over a decade.
He looks over his shoulder at Ewan and Renengild. Alas says, and by animancy's flimsy standards, that makes him an expert, does it? He folds his arms.
And he butters his bread on both sides and fits his left shoe before his right, but that's neither here nor there.
She crosses her arms and crumples the page in one tightening fist. Yeah, you know all of that about him, huh? You seem flustered all of a sudden. Did he do something to anger you?
Me and the rest of the town. He knows better than to linger at our gates.
What happened with Galvino?
Old lunatic finally went too far. And we sent word to the Valiant Academies. I don't like speaking on it, but if you want to get his guff, just remind him that we gave him the boot.
I see.
Ain't nobody here fond of the man, but he's a clever hand and a quick study. It's a fool who thinks he stayed so close to the battery without figuring something about it.
You said as much to the last party, and we haven't seen hide nor hair of him since. Maybe they didn't run afoul of Baragon's ogres after all.
She raises a gray eyebrow at him. Uldric shrugs and turns back to the fire.
Just watch your step. Galvino's place is a ways east of the battery, and folk who pass it bring unsettling tales.
Tell me about the ogre camp.
Belongs to Flames That Whisper, Matron Baragon's clan. Hunters tell me they've been active of late.
Hunting elk and otherwise minding their own damn business.
He pops an apple wedge into his mouth and chews it aggressively.
Minding their own business. Never mind the latest expedition's disappearance or the broken stockade.
She pinches the bridge of her nose, squinting.
I'm saying we shouldn't agitate him further.
He makes to toss another slice of peel into the fire, but he fumbles and drops his knife. He bends to pick it up, cursing. What does this matron have to do with anything?
The brawl outside was just the latest patch of trouble. The ogre clans are getting bolder, and we'll all sleep easier knowing they aren't circling our walls. Also, Baragons like to have whatever the last expedition found. Rumor has it they disappeared near her turf.
She crosses her arms and looks over to Uldric.
Killing a matron will only make our problems worse. The way to approach Baragon is with your hands held high.
If anyone could parley with an ogre, I suppose it'd be you. But they aren't known for their patience with prattle.
All right, got it.
Good. Before you leave town, stop by the Grave's Rest. Most visitors to Stalwart spend some time there, so Hafrick and his patrons may be able to give you the lay of the land.
Dare says, don't know about you, but I'm parched all of a sudden. Sorry, Adair. Actually, I want to ask you about something.
What's on your mind?
I want to know more about Stalwart.
Adir founded us back in their colonial days to supply ore to the Empire. Saw a fair bit of traffic from both sides of the White March then.
She rubs the nub of her shortened ring finger.
But after the Deerwood claimed independence, Defiance Bay found cheaper places to get ore. Didn't have much reason to maintain our supply routes.
Isn't Stalwart part of the Deerwood?
Officially. Though with the state the roads are in, you wouldn't guess it.
What do you do here?
I'm the mayor. Or so I'm reminded every time there's a game shortage, ogre attack, or a neighborly dispute. I'm a builder by trade, though. Traveled all over Air Glanfoth and the Deerwood in my younger days, but ended up back here anyway.
She gives you a vague smile that's gone as quickly as it appears. Tell me about some of the more important places around town.
Here in the center? Let's see. The Grave's Rest is next door. Hafrick can set you up with a room and a hot meal there. The fishery's just on the edge of the lake, and the Temple of Andra is next to it. No one keeps a secret like Lavda, or so I'm told. A few folk live in this part of town, too. Seemed a lot safer before the ogres broke through the western gate. Thirsch lives next to the old mine shaft, and Tanna, the old mine overseer, is next door to me.
She jerks her thumb toward the wall. Let's talk about something else.
What's on your mind?
Can you tell me anything about the last expedition that went to Durgan's Battery?
They didn't volunteer much, and I knew better than to ask.
She scratches her jaw, frowning.
I've seen all types charging through here. Professional companies with shiny new equipment as brazen as you please, and hopeless runts with nothing but tattered leathers. But these folk, I don't know what they were after, and the way they looked at you made you feel cold all over.
She shakes her head as if dislodging a bad dream.
Wish I could tell you more.
Perhaps we'll find more in the battery itself, yes? Aeloth nods at you with a guarded look.
What's on your mind?
I have questions about Durgan's Battery in the White Forge.
The Pargrin dwarves guarded it like a mother bear. It's a wonder we know as much as we do.
There's nothing else.
What's on your mind?
Farewell. Galvino lives in the shadow of Durgan's Battery. He may know something of interest about the keep. There's an ogre camp in the ice caves near Stalwart. The clan is led by a matron known as Barragan. Renengild wants me to kill Barragan and her followers to remove the threat to Stalwart. Barragan is also believed to have the previous expedition's goods and gear. Those items may help me with Durgan's Battery. Uldric advised against fighting Barragan. He believes I may be able to talk with her to avoid further trouble. He'll probably attempt to do that. Renengild told me that Durgan's Battery has been sealed shut since his original owners vanished over 200 years ago. Stalwart has called many other adventuring companies to the area, but none have breached the fortress. My task is more complicated than it initially seemed, but Renengild and her son gave me a couple leads. They suggested I speak with Galvino, an animancer, and Smith, and confront Matron Barragan, the leader of a local ogre clan. She's also advised me to speak to the patrons at the Grave's Rest. The innkeeper there can provide me with a hot meal and a place to rest. Hence the name Grave's Rest. Okay, so what's in here? Stuff we can't take, I know, but I'm just curious what's there. I have both these books.
I can do that.
No. Don't.
Any luck with Durgan's Battery?
We actually still haven't left your home. So about this guy, Uldric.
Something else you need?
You seem to disagree with Renengild on quite a few matters.
Mother's convinced that a magic forge will turn this frozen crack into a hub of civilization. She can't accept this place as dying. Me, I'd just as soon move on.
He scrapes the sole of his boot on the straight but weathered floorboards. Earlier you said I should make peace with Matron Berrigan.
About the only thing folk here haven't tried. Killing one more matron won't change things for long.
He shakes his head.
Besides, her clan's flames that whisper. The one that attacked us was Wolf with many mouths. I'd know him anywhere.
They're cut from the same cloth, Uldric. Only a matter of time before Berrigan marches through that gap in our walls.
At the sound of Renengild's voice, Uldric's shoulders stiffen. His jaw works in a silent but furious retort. Do you know anything about Durgan's battery?
It's a fool's hope. A fantasy that's kept these parts inhabited longer than they should be.
He glances around the old house and its worn furnishings.
They say the Pargrunan dwarves developed Durgan's steel, became powerful rich. And then one day, they locked their doors and died.
He shrugs, turning his palms toward you.
Nothing like a mystery to stir folk up. Most of Stalwart is convinced that some Pargrin secret will save us all. But that don't stop them from whispering a prayer when they pass the old fortress.
A sour smirk crosses his lips. What do you do here?
I'm a carpenter. Mother's a builder. So it felt like a good fit at the time.
He presses his lips into a wry frown.
Not that we've got a lot of new folk to build houses and furnishings for. These days, I spend most of my time fixing up the stockade.
All right, farewell. Spent so much time in here. I was feeling it was another 5 minutes, I'd call an episode now. I was supposed to ask Thyrsh something else. I'm a little hesitant to go into, Graves Arrest right now, and we're so late, I know we won't be able to explore all of it. I kind of miss the way in the original, well, the main game that, in the loading screens, the music would continue. Now it just stops every time. Kind of awkward.
Watch yourself on the mountain. In these lean times, everything looks like prey to something. Coming to your elders for advice, is it? What can I do for you?
Teodor said I should talk to you before I head to Longwatch Falls. And good thing you did. Hot springs north of the road are crawling with Lagufoeth. I'm surprised Teodor found himself out there. I wish that was voice so I knew how to say that. The thing to know about Lagufoeth is they're fast, tolerant to cold too, so try another angle of attack. Fireballs? Something seems to occur to him. He pats his pockets, clenching his pipe between his teeth. These will come in handy. Use them if you get into trouble. He hands you a few sealed bottles. The old hunter looks you up and down, puffing on a pipe. Okay. He gave us 2 potions of mirrored images. Eh. I have a power for that. But if I'm being honest, you may not even need them. You handled those ogres well enough, and you look like you could hold your own against these Lagufoeth too. He taps his pipe ash into the fire pit. Oh well. Okay, Thyrsh warned me that Lagufoeth are fast and resistant to cold. He also gave me potions that might help with the fight. I think there was somebody else I was supposed to find. Or look up again. Let's show what's going on there. I keep thinking. Are you waiting for the bathroom? Nice to see you. Alright, next episode, guys, The Grave's Rest. This is a bit shorter one, but kind of seems good to cut it off here. We talked to them for quite a bit. I'm really liking the way that so far there's a lot of voice dialogue, and it still stops at points, like what just happened with Thiersch. For the most part, yeah, so far there's a lot more voice dialogue, which I like. I like hearing all the different voices and giving my voice a rest for a bit. Anyway, thanks for watching, guys. See you next time. And endure. In enduring, grow strong.